Hachette Audio presents Denial, Self-Deception, False Beliefs, and the Origins of the Human Mind, written by Ajit Varki and Danny Brower, read by Bob Walter. Denial. An unconscious defense mechanism characterized by refusal to acknowledge painful realities, thoughts, or feelings. The American Heritage Dictionary of the English Language. Introduction. An improbable but true story. Truth is stranger than fiction. Lord Byron in Don Juan. Fiction is obliged to stick to possibilities. Truth isn't. Mark Twain in Following the Equator. The story behind this book is strange and improbable. Two individuals from very different backgrounds converged on a single question, happened to meet just once, discussed it briefly, parted company, and would never see each other again. One of them, Danny Brower, died suddenly at the age of 55 in 2007. The other person, I, a physician-turned-scientist, was left to complete our story. From our single-chance conversation grew this book, which should interest anyone who cares about the universally human questions: who are we, how did we get here, why are we the way we are, and where are we going? The improbability of it all becomes starker when you consider what different circumstances the two of us came from. Danny was born in November of 1951, was raised in the United States, and worked his way up from modest means to the prestigious position of professor and chair of molecular and cellular biology at the University of Arizona at Tucson. By the time I met him, he was already well known for his pioneering work on protein molecules called integrins, which play key roles in how cells recognize and respond to their environment. Danny was using a popular fruit fly model to study these processes, and from this same work, he was even able to contribute to our understanding of human cancer. As it turned out, Danny had another interest related to his research. He was fascinated by evolutionary biology, the study of the processes by which all life on this planet emerged over the last 3 billion years or so. A natural progression of such thinking made him wonder about the origin of our own species, Homo sapiens. As for me, I was born just 2 months after Danny, but was raised on the other side of the planet, in India. I grew up in a traditional Orthodox Christian family from the southern state of Kerala, but attended English language schools and went on to medical college with the idealistic goal of saving lives. But as it happens, the curriculum in medicine includes a strong dose of fascinating biology. Inspired by this aspect of my education, I finally decided that I could contribute more to society by becoming a biomedical researcher. However, opportunities to pursue this track in India were sparse in the 1970s. Reading the scientific literature, I realized that the United States was the one country in the world where physicians were being encouraged and supported in their efforts to do research side by side with other kinds of scientists. Thus it was that I emigrated to the United States in 1975 with $6 and a suitcase, eventually becoming board certified in internal medicine, hematology, and oncology, and working my way up to my present position as a professor at the University of California, San Diego, UC San Diego. Just as I had originally hoped, this career path allowed me to pursue my passion for science and research, and eventually took me away from patient care and into the emerging field of glycobiology, which studies the dense, complex, and varied forest of sugar chains that are now known to cover every one of the cells in our bodies. Technical difficulties in analyzing these glycans resulted in their getting limited attention in the early stages of the molecular biology revolution, which had focused mostly on DNA, RNA, and proteins. But we now know that these glycan chains are essential for life and that they are involved in every normal and abnormal state of the body, from infections to cancer to brain development. While starting up my independent research career, I still continued to see patients part-time as a physician and cancer specialist. The latter role naturally led me to ponder issues of life and death, particularly the question of how it was that patients with terminal cancer could so courageously fight to stay alive against all odds. It seemed to me that both patient and physician were actually denying the reality of what they were up against, even in the face of a grim prognosis. But then, optimistic thinking that helps us go on despite the odds doesn't just feature in life or death situations. It is part and parcel of what makes us human and comes across in so many of our activities. These and other life experiences, such as watching my own daughter grow up, made me wonder about how we became human, evolving away from a recent common ancestor with our closest living evolutionary cousins, the chimpanzees, and other so-called great apes, gorillas, bonobos, and orangutans. Although great apes and humans look rather different, scientists as far back as in the 1960s and 1970s had shown that we are genetically very similar. In fact, viewed from the perspective of genes, we are more similar to chimpanzees than mice and rats are to each other. And chimpanzees have more in common with us genetically than they do with gorillas. So the big question has been, why are we humans so different from chimpanzees and gorillas in appearance, behavior, and so many other features, while they seem so similar to each other? Why is it that a chimpanzee or gorilla cannot do what I am doing right now, communicating with a listener about stories of past events with implications for our future? And although we may have never met each other, how is it that you, the listener, understand what I am thinking? And how do I know that you might be doing so? In 1984, my thoughts about such matters were very suddenly brought into focus. I was seeing a patient who had an immune reaction to a horse serum that had been administered to treat a rare blood disease. What I learned from this case inspired additional research, and by the mid-1990s, my research group had uncovered the first known clear-cut genetic difference between humans and great apes. In fact, scientists had been searching for 2 decades for genetic features that were uniquely different in humans, and I was lucky enough to find the very first example, the loss of a gene called CMAH, or CMA, which had subtly but uniquely altered the cell surface sugars called sialic acids on all cells in the human body. Since then, we have found several additional uniquely human changes in sialic acid biology that seem to contribute to the human condition in health and disease. But that's another story for another time. These unexpected findings stoked my already keen interest in something quite far removed from my original training, an explanation for the origins of the human species. Where we humans came from is undoubtedly one of our greatest unsolved mysteries, at least from the human perspective. And while the work of many scientists had painted the broad brushstrokes of how this might have happened, there was precious little known at the time about any molecules and biological processes unique to humans. So by the late 1990s, I began to focus my research specifically on this area of anthropogeny. This classic but long unused term encompasses the scientific pursuit of human origins and evolution. As you can imagine, this fascinating field of inquiry requires understanding of a rather wide range of subjects, many of which I was not trained in. But having achieved a modicum of scientific success and recognition in my primary research fields of medicine and glycobiology, I could now afford to devote more time to this new quest, immersing myself in other relevant specialties, such as primatology, evolutionary biology, neuroscience, linguistics, and anthropology. As part of this self-education quest, I began to seek advice from various experts in such fields, a process that eventually led to my forming, in 1996, an international transdisciplinary collaborative group of researchers interested in human origins and evolution. Supported primarily by the Mathers Foundation of New York, this group was recently expanded and renamed the Center for Academic Research and Training in Anthropogeny, or CARTA. In this Center Without Walls, affiliated with UC San Diego and the Salk Institute for Biological Studies, CARTA brings together academicians from the natural sciences, social sciences, and biomedical sciences, along with interested parties from the humanities and arts, as well as contributors from the earth sciences, engineering, mathematics, and computing sciences.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.